great Brian Leach.
Connecticut Hockey is so proud to have you as part of our family, and I'm sure that they would love to hear about your amazing career. But you had a 90 mile an hour fastball in high school, and you set the record with, what, 19 strikeouts? Explain to me how you went from baseball to hockey and how you chose hockey over baseball.
Well, I had certainly played higher competitive hockey at a younger age, 16, 17 years old. I was playing for the U.S. team in the Junior Nationals when we'd gone over to Finland and been to Canada and Czechoslovakia and played against guys that were in college and against, you know, other countries, top level. Baseball, I'd only played whatever league I was playing in. And there were always guys that could throw the ball hard. It was a big difference than throwing a ball and being able to pitch. And it just never occurred to me that I could go on and play baseball further. I suppose if hockey wasn't an option to go on to college and play college hockey, I certainly would have gone to wherever I could have played baseball in college. I can't say that I loved hockey so much more than baseball. I enjoyed the practices more. I didn't really look forward to baseball practices, standing around and waiting for batting practice. But I enjoyed baseball when I played it. But to me, hockey was where most of my friends were involved with, and something that I saw myself being able to go on to college and play.
After your first year with Boston College, you went on to the 1988 Olympics. Tell me, how did it make you feel when your hockey career was skyrocketing and everyone else your age was just a regular college student?
Well, I certainly never felt that way personally. I mean, I think you're drawn to friends and you develop friendships based on your personalities and what you have in common. So I certainly had a lot of friends that were on the hockey team, but guys that I weren't on the hockey team with were just as excited, you know, to share in your experiences and to watch you, you know, go on and represent your country.
Did you ever feel like you weren't exactly, that you maybe were missing out on college life because of hockey?
Well, I knew I was missing out on it talking to my friends, believe me. And when that season was, when the Olympics were over, I actually turned pro instead of going back to college. But as soon as that year was over in the NHL, we didn't make the playoffs. I was right back living in the dorm for three weeks while they were going through exams, and I had a little bit of money in my pocket now, so instead of $20 lasting you 2 months, you know, I was able to go treat at the 99 restaurant or stop by McDonald's.
And you were chosen as a first round draft from the New York Rangers. What was the first thing that ran through your mind?
I think that was the first time I realized that I'd get a chance to play in the NHL. I think in my mind, my goal was the 1988 Olympics, and I could see myself progressing and maybe getting a chance. It was still amateurs then. A lot of young players were playing, college players, teenagers even. And when you get drafted in the first round, you realize that that team's going to give you an opportunity to come to training camp and to try and make the team. They don't just draft you there and say, good luck, we'll see you later. So that was the first time it really hit me, like, wow, the NHL, I've got a chance, you know, to make this a living or to make it a career.
Didn't they want you before you went to college, though?
Well, they always want to get a control of you first, but that doesn't mean you're going to play on the Rangers, that you could go to the minors and play in the minor leagues. The rules were different then. Now you either got to go back to juniors or back to college, but you can't as an underage, go to the minors. So back then you could, and you could get stuck there, you know, for years riding the bus and missing out on schooling instead of getting those years taken care of. So, and I didn't think I was ready yet. So I took that sophomore year took it off to practice with the Olympic team, played the Olympics. And by the end of that, I knew I was prepared to go to the NHL.
And how did it feel to be the first non-Canadian to win the Conn Smythe Trophy?
Yeah, it was great. I mean, at the time, when you win the Conn Smythe, you're just so overwhelmed with winning the Stanley Cup. And really, the Conn Smythe goes to someone usually on the winning team. It's only been a couple times that the losing team has a player that has won it. And I got a lot of ice time, and they could have easily picked Mark Messier or Mike Richter, you know, very important players to our team. But looking back on it, very, very proud, you know, to be the first American you know, to win that. And unfortunately, it's still the only American. It'd be great if we could have more guys, you know, being able to accomplish that. But yeah, I'm very proud of it.
In 1992, you became the fifth defenseman and first American to score over 100 points, and you won the Norris Trophy as well. Would you say that you're more offensive-minded than defensive?
Well, I think when you're scoring a lot of points, you get labeled that regardless. And the flip side is if you don't score a lot of points, you get labeled a defensive defenseman. But you really have to be able to do both in the NHL to stay in the league. If you're no good in your own zone, they'll move you to forward, you know, if you can't play defense. So I would say that was certainly some of my natural strengths, was skating and passing and moving up in the play. But you learn each level you are what you need to do to be a good defenseman in your zone. And that's what I learned in the NHL, and it's the reason that I played, you know, close to 30 minutes a game and was out on the penalty kills, as well as the power play and in goal situations. But you can't really win the trust of your coach and your teammates unless you can play at both ends of the ice. And that goes for guys that aren't scoring a lot of points, is they're not just expected to clear the front of the net and hit guys. They need to make accurate passes out of the zone. They need to move up and know when to pinch in on the boards, know when to get a shot through in traffic. And they may not score all the time, and they may not be out there in scoring positions, but they're expected to contribute on the offensive side, even when they're not getting a lot of points. So to play in the NHL and make a career, you need to learn every zone, and you need to be better, because they'll bring someone in that will take your spot.
Most kids fantasize about winning the Stanley Cup. What was it like to hoist the Stanley Cup?
Yeah, it was the best. I mean, it was every emotion you can imagine, and there was certainly a lot of relief. The Rangers hadn't won in 54 years, and we were in a game 7 at home, and it was the middle of June. We've been playing hockey for a long time. So to win it, everybody's injured, and your body's really worn down, so there's a sense of relief, a unbelievable sense of excitement, kind of a awe at the reaction to the fans and to people around you, and then an unbelievable feeling of satisfaction and enjoying sharing that satisfaction with your teammates that you accomplished something that you worked every day for, and then, like you talked about, that you dreamed of, and now it's become a reality. So many emotions mixed into a short period of time, but that was the only time I ever made the finals. And I was lucky enough that we were able to win the Stanley Cup. Some players get multiple shots at it and win more than one cup. Some players never get a chance at it. So very, very fortunate.
You were talking about accomplishments. What would you say is your greatest accomplishment during your hockey career?
For sure, that Stanley Cup, like we talked about. So much goes into that with your teammates over 8-9 month period, and to reach that, that was absolutely the pinnacle. On the international side, though, in 1996, I was part of a team that represented the U.S. in a World Cup, and we were in a 3-game final with Canada, and we lost the first game in the U.S. in Philadelphia, and we had to go to Montreal. And for us to win it, we need to win 2 games in Montreal, and we won that first one pretty handily, and we went into that last one behind 2-1 with like 5 minutes left, and we were able to score 4 goals in the last 5 minutes. Wow. And win that. So we won 2 games in Canada, and that tournament was only 3.5-4 weeks long, right into the through training camp. So that was a big accomplishment for USA Hockey, and certainly something that I was very proud of.
So what are you doing now that you're retired from hockey?
No heavy lifting. A little bit of a lot of things is the way I like to put it. I do a little bit of TV in New York for the Ranger games. I do a little bit of TV here for a show after Bruins games. I do some things on the internet, and then I help out with all my kids' sports, help coach in baseball and in hockey, and lucky enough to be a big part of their lives and being around home. And I do a little bit more work with friends' charities that I wasn't able to do when I was playing and busy all the time. So, like I said, a lot of things spread out, but only a little bit here and there.
What's it like going from being a player to being a coach?
Well, youth coach is fun, you know, and I guess it depends what type of kids you get, and certainly the parents, whether they're supporting their kids are really trying to push and be aggressive, and I'm very lucky to be in a good spot here. They play for Charlestown, Mass, and we've got great kids. They listen, they work hard, they all get along, and the parents are the same. They're very happy that their kids are having fun out there. So it's fun. I enjoy it. I'm at the right age for it, too.
And what do you think is most important about kids getting involved with youth hockey or any other youth sport?
Yeah, I think sports and athletics in general are extremely important for kids. I have a 10-year-old, a 7-year-old, and a 5-year-old right now, and so they're doing a little bit of everything too. They take their swimming lessons. We have them at tumbling and gymnastics classes. They play baseball. They play hockey or learn to skate. And I tell them, I said, if you don't like it, you know, in a couple of years, you can stop, but you need to find something that you enjoy doing, because you can't just come home and sit at home. You need to stay active. And all that comes with that is self-confidence in doing something that you might have to practice at, and you're not as good as somebody else on your team. Certainly teamwork and team sports is important. And just social interacting, you know, they're not always kids from your class or kids from your neighborhood that you're participating with. So all those are very important as a child growing up.
And what are some of your words of wisdom for our kids of Connecticut youth hockey?
Same thing I tell my kids here is to have fun, do your best, and listen to your coaches. Those three things. When I see my son doing something, not listening to his coaches or not trying his hardest, that's the only time I get upset. So I know he's having fun. It's it's the listening and doing your best. It's only a short time you're out there in hockey. It's not like in baseball where you can be at practice for 3 hours or you've got the field for a lot longer. And in hockey, you got a short time, so just go out there and work hard.
We want to extend a big thank you to Brian Leach for sharing his tremendous hockey background and experience with us. That's our show for today in Boston. I'm Kristen Liebisch, and this has been Gotta Love Connecticut Hockey.